Good evening, everyone, and happy Malcolm X Day. On behalf of the DC Public Library, I welcome you to tonight's program, Black Power in DC. My name is Derek Gray, and I am an archivist in the People's Archive at the Martin Luther King Jr. Memorial Library. For those of you who are longtime patrons of the library, you know us as the former Washingtoniana Division. The People's Archive collects, preserves, and provides access to collections and materials of historical importance documenting the social, cultural, and political life of the District of Columbia, and connects the community to its history and culture through creative engagement and public programming. The People's Archive comprises four units: the Washingtoniana Collection, which established in 1905, includes books, microfilm, maps, and subject reference files focusing on the cultural, historical, and social life of Washington. The Peabody Room, established in 1935, is a local archive of Georgetown history and housed at the Georgetown Neighborhood Library. The DC Community Archives, founded in 1987, contains archival material including photos, personal papers, organizational records, and manuscripts. And the Black Studies Collection, established in 1972, contains secondary sources about the African-American experience with an emphasis on social justice. Our event tonight could not be more appropriate, as today, May 19th, we commemorate the 96th anniversary of the birth of Malcolm X, also known as Al-Haj Malik El-Shabazz. I am pleased to welcome tonight's speaker. George Derek Musgrove, PhD, is an associate professor of history and Africana studies at the University of Maryland, Baltimore County. He is the author of Rumor, Repression, and Racial Politics: How the Harassment of Black Elected Officials Shaped Post-Civil Rights America, and co-author with Chris Myers Ash of Chocolate City: A History of Race and Democracy in the Nation's Capital. Great book. His latest project is Black Power in Washington, D.C., a web-based map of Black Power activism in the nation's capital between 1961 and 1998. His work has appeared in the Washington Post, National Public Radio, the New York Times, and The Root. He is currently working on a book project tentatively titled, We Must Take to the Streets Again: The Black Power Resurgence in Conservative America, 1980 to 1997, which explores the burst of Black activism that rose in opposition to the urban crisis and the conservative retrenchment. He earned his PhD from New York University in 2005, and now lives with his wife and two sons in Washington, D.C. Derek, welcome, and thank you for doing this program with us.
Well, thank you. This feels like one of those weird handoffs between, you know, Don Lemon and Cuomo. But nonetheless, I think we're going to do a much better job of than those guys. Before you leave the screen, Derek, I just have to say thank you. Thank you so much. Everyone who's listening, without Derek Gray and the good people at the Washingtoniana Division, I simply would not have been able to do the project that I'm about to show to you all this evening. They spent countless hours digging photos of all types of Black Power activists and organizations and places out of the archives. And so my hat's off to you, Derek. Thank you so much for all that good work. And I'm excited to show everyone some of the fruits of your labor. So whenever you're ready, I can pivot over to the next screen.
Sure. Yeah. Thank you for your words. And let me just say before I hand it off, it is so wonderful that our material is been included in a great project like this, and congratulations on it. It was really great to help out as an archivist. I always like to see our resources used. So there are two Derricks in the house. People signed on to hear Derek Musgrove, so I am going to pass it off to you. Please, folks, send your questions after Derek's presentation. We're going to have a little discussion, and we're going to have some Q&A. So, Derek, it's your show.
Thanks again, Derek. Yeah. I'm going to go ahead and pull up these slides and begin talking through them, everyone. And then I'm really excited to come back and be in discussion with Derek Gray about some of this material. And so I'm going to take about 25 minutes to do this, and then we can get into a robust question and answer afterward. So I'm going to be speaking tonight about Black Power in Washington, D.C., which is my new website. And you can find it here on Kwame Ture's shirt, blackpowerindc.umbc.edu. I wanted just to begin with this picture, though, and talk about this picture before I get into the slides, because it is just so indicative of the tremendous impact that the Black Power movement and then the later Black Power resurgence had on Washington, D.C. Here we have in this picture, which was taken in 1979, newly elected Mayor Marion Barry, a former Black Power activist with, of course, SNCC and then Pride Incorporated, the D.C. Alliance of Active Black Businessmen, and several other organizations. And he is the first Black Power activist in the United States of America to rise to the chief executive position in a major American city. And so just his being there was remarkable. But what was even more remarkable is that he invited into the chambers of the district building the Third World Revolutionary and the head of the All-African People's Revolutionary Party, Kwame Ture, who was in town for Malcolm X Day as well as African Liberation Day. In the latter, he had been hosting in Malcolm X Park for some years at this point. And the real encapsulation of this picture is that Kwame Ture walks into the office and Marion Barry sort of jokingly, Marion Barry walks in to greet Kwame Ture, and Kwame Ture sort of jokingly says, "My leader," to this mayor of Washington, D.C. And so things very obviously in the person of these two individuals and where they stood in this moment had changed quite dramatically from just a few years before, when racists from West Virginia and South Carolina and Mississippi ruled over the District of Columbia. Now, here is a quick synopsis of the map, and then I'll get into some of the guts of what's in there. The map is basically laid out with two things. You land on this first page that has this wonderful picture of Jamil El-Amin, as well as Baba Zulu, and then Marion Barry standing outside the SNCC headquarters on U Street. And after you scroll past that picture, you see this narrative essay about the Black Power movement and Black Power resurgence in Washington, D.C. And that was really just my effort to get you grounded in this roughly generation-long span of history that I cover in the map. Because I'm not only talking about the Black Power movement, but the sort of larger Black Power generation that puts its stamp on Washington, D.C. politics from 1961 to roughly 1998. But after you get through past that narrative essay, you get to go into the maps. And there are four different maps rooted in the four different moments that I'm going to discuss in my talk tonight. And each map has all of the major Black Power organizations and events that I could find in the written record. And they're plotted by their address on a map of Washington, D.C. And so you can see you have a good understanding from reading not just when things happened and what exactly it was that happened, but also where things happened and how they sort of are laid out in relationship to other Black Power events in the city. So let's get the story started. You cannot tell the story of Black Power politics in Washington, D.C. without understanding a pretty profound contradiction at the core of Washington, D.C. politics in the 1950s. And that is that in the 1950s, the city is overseen not just by a predominantly white Congress, and specifically predominantly white committees in the House and in the Senate, but specifically by people who are dedicated to segregation on those committees. Those are the people who are overseeing Washington, D.C. people like John McMillan of South Carolina, who, when a Washington Post reporter went to go interview him in his office, he regularly used the word "nigra," and he had a little cartoon on his door of a rebel soldier saying, "I will never surrender." Then, of course, you had Robert Byrd. I think many of us think of Robert Byrd, and he's in the Senate. John McMillan was in the House. We think of Robert Byrd as that old guy that really understood the history of the Senate and was friends with Barack Obama. But in the 1950s, he was a racist who regularly sabotaged D.C. services, particularly services to the black poor, and then turned around and said, look, the city is dysfunctional. The Negroes simply don't know how to handle themselves as citizens. We absolutely should not give the city the vote. And keep in mind that before 1968, the only thing that D.C. residents could vote for was president. And we received that right in 1961, had the opportunity to first vote for president in 1964. But at the same time that these folks are running the city is becoming majority black. In fact, in 1957, D.C. became the first major American city to have a black majority in these United States of America. And that was because of two things. The first, so you can see in the orange line, is that when the federal government clearly signaled to the white population of Washington, D.C. that it would not protect segregation, they left in droves. Quite literally, 300,000 of them left just in the span of about 20 years. And so you can see there's well over 500,000 white D.C. residents at the end of World War II. But once you get the end of racially restrictive housing covenants in 1948, the end of racially restricted schooling in 1954, you see quite literally 170,000 white D.C. residents leaving in the 1950s and another 130,000 leaving in the 1960s. Most of this before the riot, before the revolt of 1968. At the same time, African Americans are moving in to the area. They cannot go to the suburbs like many white D.C. residents are doing because the suburbs are segregated. And so hundreds of thousands of them, about 200,000 between the end of World War II and 1960, pack into the city. And as their numbers go up and the white numbers go down, you get a black majority in 1957. By the time that you get to 1975, when Parliament Funkadelic famously takes a nickname for the city and cuts an entire album around it. And you can see that album cover right at the top of the gray line. DC has well over 500,000 African-Americans and they constitute more than 70% of the population. And so this imbalance between white power and black population is really the fertile soil in which the black power movement grows. In other words, black folks are looking to exercise power in those places where they are majority of the population, something called democracy. So let me talk about the origins of black power activism in the city from 1961 to 1965. This is a period before we actually start talking about all of this as black power, but just we call it like black nationalist organizing, things of that nature. And the person that is key to spreading black power style ideas. And when I say black power style ideas, what I'm really talking about are those three elements that we associate with black power: black self-love, self-determination, and self-defense. And the person who is the most articulate, the most well-traveled, and the most influential person who is spreading those ideas in America in the early 1960s is Malcolm X. And of course, we are celebrating his birthday today. Malcolm X was regularly in Washington, D.C. In 1961, he came to Uline Arena to rally about 10,000 people. The Nation of Islam had already been at Uline Arena 2 years before in 1959, where they rallied about 10,000 people. Malcolm X actually came and was the interim minister of Mosque Number 4, which was then on New Jersey Avenue, in 1963. And on all these trips, but particularly when he actually stayed in the city in 1963, he was very influential, talking to people like Julius Hobson, but also the young activists of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee who were at Howard University. And so he's spreading his notion of black nationalism, his notion of what we would later call black power, to much of the rest of the black political community in the city. Now, the key person that he spread some of those ideas to, and a person that would really become his friend and his confidant over time was Julius Hobson, easily the most ubiquitous social protest leader in the city in the early 1960s, and arguably one of the most influential. Hobson takes Malcolm X's ideas of Black self-determination, self-defense, and self-love, and really actualizes them on the streets of Washington, D.C. And so for those of you who have read Chocolate City or some of the other great works that are out there on Washington, D.C., you know that legally, on paper, the city is thoroughly desegregated by the mid-1950s. And yet here we are in the early 1960s, and what you see is white power in a Black population. What you also see is remarkable poverty and still widespread and rank discrimination in the city. And Hobson tries to use very disruptive protests to force people away from that sort of inequality of result, and to try and match up the promise of legal reform with the actuality of equality in Black people's lives. He's standing here next to his station wagon, which he turned into a sound truck. And I use this picture to represent you know, his time with the Associated Community Teams, which is an organization that he actually founded with Malcolm X. But probably his most famous protest from his time with Associated Community Teams was his rat rallies that he held right at the corner of First and Florida Avenue. So DC had a horrible rat problem, particularly in the African-American communities of the center city, places like Shaw, but also Columbia Heights. And the city would by and large not do anything about it. And the city elites, the white power folks that I just mentioned, were not gonna appropriate any money to do anything about it. And so Hobson actually catches some of those rats, straps them to a cage on the top of his car, holds a press conference and says, "I caught all these, you know, massive, you know, sort of cat and chihuahua and small dog style size rats in Black communities. And until you all do something, white power structure, to kill these rats in Black communities where they're biting children and spreading disease and things like that, I'm going to keep catching them and letting them out in Georgetown," which of course had already gentrified into a not just a white, but a very affluent community at that point. And of course he would take the rats down the Potomac and drown them. But they, you know, these protests got the attention, not just of white DC residents who were afraid of them, but Black DC residents who really cheered them on. Now, you have Malcolm X's ideas, Julius Hobson's very disruptive style of protest. Let's talk about how those two things sort of were actualized as a movement in 1966 and after. One of the big ways that those ideas and styles of protest spread across the entire city was, oddly enough, that the federal government funded them. The federal government, of course, initiated its war on poverty in 1965, and it flooded money into Washington, D.C. through the United Planning Organization after 1965 to deal with issues of poverty in the city. One of the organizations that received some of that money, and one that held very disruptive protests after receiving that money, and raised up an entire generation of very powerful protest leaders from primarily the ranks of welfare recipients and people who lived in public housing, was a citywide welfare alliance founded by Etta Horn and some of her neighbors. Etta Horn was on welfare. She lived in Berry Farms. She knew, as did many of the people who were in her situation, that the welfare bureaucracy in Washington, D.C. treated the women who received benefits, who received help, positively terribly. And so when she was able to amass that money, she focused on making sure that women who received welfare were treated like human beings. And in fact, people who were in public housing were treated like human beings. And so this picture is from a citywide welfare alliance protest in 1967 down by the Capitol. It's pretty tame looking. But if you fast forward just 3 years and headed over to H Street, you'll see members of the citywide welfare alliance actually physically fighting with members of the MPD in a very raucous protest at the city's welfare offices, where they were essentially demanding a furniture allowance for people who were in public housing. They were told to disperse. They were roughly handled by the MPD, and they fought back because they were essentially possessed of this idea that they could demand equality of result, not just the promise of some equality if maybe they acted better or were in a different class group. Now, there were also large numbers of African Americans in the city who refused to take federal money. And they did that because they thought that federal money meant a certain level of federal control. And so I want to talk about one of those groups now, and that's the New School of African American Thought. And you can see the building in this picture. Kwame Ture, then known as Stokely Carmichael, is in the center of the picture, and I'll tell you exactly what he's doing in just a moment. But the New School of African American Thought was founded by a number of activists, among them Gaston Neal, the famous poet, who really wanted to make sure that they were not receiving federal money so that they could open up sort of a community school that trained African Americans to prepare themselves and their larger community for revolution, right? And so they held actual classes in this building. They had classes on African American history. They had classes on self-defense. They had all the things that they thought that African Americans would need in order to stand up their own functional, autonomous Black communities outside of the reach of white control. And there were a bunch of classes meeting in the New School in October of 1968, which is right near the intersection of 14th and Florida Avenue, when they heard gunshots about two or three blocks away. A lot of people headed outside, and they found out that there was a gentleman down the street. It was a young father of four. It was probably weighed about 150 pounds soaking wet. And he had been jaywalking. An officer, member of the MPD, had tried to stop him. Like 80%+ of the officers in the MPD at that time, this officer was white and did not live in the neighborhood. And when the young man essentially roughly handled the officer, actually took a swing at him for trying to grab his shoulder to keep him from jaywalking, the officer pulled out his revolver and shot him dead right there in the middle of U Street. And so these folks are pouring out of the New School to find that this has happened. And they immediately stage a protest called the Jaywalk Protest, where they literally sat down in the middle of U and 14th Street, stopping traffic in one of the busiest intersections of Washington, D.C., in every direction. They then demanded demanded police reforms. And out of this protest and others like it grew a demand, really sort of carried forward by Stokely Carmichael, for community control of the police, something that many of you have probably heard in our discussions of Black Lives Matter in recent days. That was actually realized, that desire for community control, in the pilot district project that took place just a few years later. Now, aside from these sort of hyper-local issues of police violence towards African Americans. And by the way, I should just go back and say, folks reacted so negatively to what had happened at this moment, not just because this young man had been shot by the police, but because he was the 13th African American man shot dead by the MPD officers in just the previous year and a half. And so they, in DC, only in DC, and so they clearly understood that there was a pattern of white cops not just shooting African-American men, the vast majority of them unarmed, but getting away with it, with local authorities identifying the shootings as justifiable. Now, aside from these local issues, we also have to remember that DC is the nation's capital. It's a place where U.S. foreign policy is formulated down in Foggy Bottom, and where countries around the world establish their embassies, at least those that have formal relationships with the United States. And Washington, D.C. activists knew this and took advantage of that situation to begin creating an impulse among African Americans that focused on ending colonialism in Africa, and specifically in Southern Africa, where colonialism and white settler governments had really maintained a hold on the continent even after two decades of decolonization. And so in the weekend just after we are right here, and so it's always the last weekend in May, right after Malcolm X's birthday, these activists decide to go to Malcolm X Park and hold African Liberation Day. The first one was held in 1972, and African Liberation Day is held nonstop all the way through to 1990. Initially, it's a huge coalition that puts on the rally and parade. And so this picture from 1972 depicts sort of the front end of a parade that contained approximately 25,000 people and a very broad coalition of everyone from members of Congress to Third World revolutionaries from Newark, New Jersey, like Amiri Baraka. And so it was a really remarkable undertaking. And it just so happens that many of the people that worked on African Liberation Day would continue for decades to come to be a part of the district's real focus on Southern African liberation. So many of the activists that worked on ALD also worked on the Free South Africa campaign in the 1980s, were part of the Southern Africa Support Project that operated in the district in the late 1970s and early 1980s. And so they really seeded an entire generation of international activism that made DC sort of this hotbed of the anti-apartheid movement a full decade after this picture was taken. Now, let me talk about the process of institutionalization, because what you essentially see is that all these street activists, at least in the district, end up having tremendous effect. I mean, this is not a sort of movement that doesn't get results. It takes over the government. In fact, it creates a government and then takes it over. We have to remember that when the Black Power movement starts in Washington, D.C., there isn't a government in D.C. But starting in 1968, you get school board elections. After that, you get the non-voting delegate in 1971. And then, of course, after 1974, you get a council and a mayor. And if you just look at the council and the mayor's office, you can see what a remarkable effect the Black Power movement had on the district. Not only was the district the first place where you got a former Black Power activist who ascend to a mayor's office, Marion Barry was the second mayor during the Home Rule period, the first, of course, being Walter Washington. But if you look at the council that is seated in January 1975, the first democratically elected council in 100 years, you notice that a supermajority of them are anti-poverty, Black Power, and civil rights activists. Even among the white members, people like David Clark, who had previously worked for the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. And so the movement quite literally takes over the government. And it's not just that they take over the government, but they actually use that government to institutionalize some of the celebrations that people had begun to have here in the district during the Civil Rights and Black Power era, and specifically during the Black Power era. Of course, we have Anacostia, the Anacostia MLK Day parade starting in 1978. This was the first municipal parade honoring the birthday of Martin Luther King that would take place on his birthday. Most other municipalities would have it on the weekend so that they didn't have a day off. But DC government would actually close the government and close schools in honor of Martin Luther King, way ahead of any other city in this regard. And in fact, the parade became such an important focal point that the person who penned the birthday song, and in fact was at this moment the chief advocate for a national holiday for Martin Luther King, Stevie Wonder, came and sat as the Grand Marshal for the Anacostia MLK Day Parade in 1979. But you can add that, you know, aside from just the MLK Day Parade, you had Malcolm X Day, which took place in Anacostia Park pretty much from the late 1970s all the way through to the mid-1990s. You, of course, had African Liberation Day, which took place during this period as well. But then you had sort of more liberal manifestations of these Black celebrations, like the Congressional Black Caucus's annual legislative conference and other large events like that. And so not only was the city controlled by these former movement activists, but many of the celebrations and celebrate and sort of recognitions of Black history that they had instituted during the movement, they actually brought into the city government and made part of the city's everyday or sort of annual set of celebrations. Now, if we ended the story there, this would be an amazing story, right? I mean, look, the movement not only took place on the streets, it headed into government, it, you know, sort of institutionalized itself in government, and everything's fine, and Black folks are equal, done deal. And of course, we know that that didn't happen. as soon as this picture was taken, the bottom was dropping out of the economy. And you have a massive recession that washes over the late Carter and the Reagan years. And Black unemployment is a solid double, if not more, of white unemployment during this time. In 1982, Black unemployment in DC is at Depression era levels, around 20%. Youth unemployment is well over 40% in Washington, DC. But on top of that, you also had the rise in 1980 of a sort of conservative government under Ronald Reagan, who was determined to cut many of the programs that had been institutionalized in the 60s and 70s to help the poor, and specifically to help the poor in cities. In other words, to help Black people. And in the midst of this economic crisis and the political crisis of the rise of mass conservatism, you have African Americans heading back out into the streets to try and save their communities and save the larger society. I'll focus first on the efforts to try and save their communities. The Black family reunion is perhaps one of the least studied and most fascinating, and I think most important, efforts to try and save the Black community of the 1980s and the 1990s. Dorothy Height and her National Council of Negro Women, which is of course headquartered down on Pennsylvania Avenue, started a celebration of Black family life in the mid-1980s, specifically to combat ideas that had been circulating in the news of unwed Black mothers, Black drug use, Black family disintegration, and to remind African Americans of the family values that had sustained them through centuries of slavery and segregation. Her worry was that the very moment when Black folks were on the cusp of freedom, they were losing those values and therefore becoming vulnerable to the economic downturn and the Reagan retrenchment. This celebration took place on the Mall with help from the Smithsonian Institution and the city government, and it will continue all the way through the 1990s into the new millennium. What you also saw during this period were huge protests like the Million Man March, which actually takes a great deal of its inspiration from the Black family reunion. But just for the sake of time, I want to end with one terribly important event that really marks for me the passing of the Black power generation from the scene in Washington, D.C., and the sort of rise of a more technocratic post-racial generation in the city's leadership. And that is the Kwame Ture tribute dinner, which took place in 1998. Kwame Ture, who many of you may know, after he left Washington, D.C., moved to Conakry in Guinea on the west coast of Africa and served out his time there as the head of the All African People's Revolutionary Party, trying to foment a worldwide revolution in the creation of a socialist Africa. And he developed cancer in the 1990s. And in order to pay for some of the treatment that he was receiving, some of it in Cuba, he stopped here in Washington, D.C., where a huge number of his friends still lived and were still in political office, and had a fundraising and tribute dinner at the hotel right across from the zoo. I believe it's a Hilton. I'm embarrassed that I don't recall right now. And what was remarkable about the event is that many of the people that sort of splash across the Black Power in DC website from the 60s all the way down to the late 1990s, show up at this dinner all in one place. And so you've got John Lewis, his old comrade from the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, with his back slightly to the camera on the right-hand side of this picture. Marion Barry, who is, of course, the mayor on the other side of the picture. Louis Farrakhan was there. Amiri Baraka was there. You could go on and on and on. A couple of dozen members of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee were there. And what's important about this picture and this event for me and for the end of the project is that Kwame Ture would pass soon after this picture was taken. But just as importantly for Black Power politics in D.C., Marion Barry would decide a month after this picture was taken to announce that he was not running for a fifth term as mayor of the district. And say what you may about Marion Barry, he brought a very specific style of politics and understanding of how the government could be used to redistribute resources to the poor into the mayor's office. And that was at the core of the Black Power politics that had dominated the city for a generation. In his stead rose a different set of leaders that had a different set of commitments and a different set of politics. And so I identify this moment as the end of Black Power politics in the city's history. I'll just end with this really quickly. What I really hope this this website will do is serve as a sort of point of instruction, inspiration, and as a cautionary tale to all of us as we wrestle with the Black Lives Matter insurgency that's happening outside of our windows and doors right now. But also for the activists who are driving that insurgency. I think there's a great deal that young people can learn from an intergenerational dialogue with the activists of the Black Power movement and the Black Power resurgence. I also think that they can learn some negative, sort of examples of what not to do from some of those same people. In fact, I know that many of them have already fashioned their politics around sort of, not wanting to be like the way that Jesse Jackson and Louis Farrakhan, for instance, organized their organizations in the 1980s and 1990s. And so I hope that, we can have a great conversation about what all of this means. And I hope that folks can take that that understanding into our discussions of the Black Power movement that appears to be happening outside of our doors today. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Derek. As always, I always learn something new with your presentations. Going back to Hobson and Malcolm X, I figured that they knew each other, mm-hmm. But I didn't know that they were friends. One question for you. Hobson was involved in the making sure that things were orderly at the March on Washington, mm-hmm. And trained individuals to move people about. Malcolm X called it the farce on Washington. Did that cause any friction in their relationship or?
I can't say. My understanding of their relationship really sort of starts around the time that they're deciding to work together and to create ACT. And so you're talking about 1964 going into 1965. Mm-hmm. And so 1963, I'm just not sure. I mean, Hobson's a complicated figure, as you well know. I mean, he's very socially conservative. He's much more Marxist than I think most members of the Black Power movement, at least at the time that he's a prominent activist in the early 1960s. Many would come to his positions much later on at a time when he was moving away from some of those positions and becoming more liberal. So I can't say what they were doing then. What I can say is that, they came together in 1964 around the idea that Black folks should be able to seize the reins of power in those places where they constitute a majority of the population. And that one strategy in seizing the reins of power in those places was marginalizing more sort of liberal, what they called Uncle Tom Black figures, and sort of pushing forward more radical figures who were more nationalist in their politics. And so, Malcolm was looking to people like not just Julius Hobson, but Gloria Richardson in Cambridge, Maryland, Jesse Gray in New York City. And he was really interested in working with those people as part of a national network of more strident Black Power style activists before people were using the term.
Yeah, and one thing that emerges with your website and your project is how I think the Black Power movement basically crushed the other civil rights organizations in the city. For example, the local branch of the NAACP for a long time was the sole organization, quite dominant. But by the 60s, what they were saying about these organizations is very closely aligned to what Calvin Chase was saying back way back when the NAACP started to emerge. He just he said it just wasn't going to thrive as an organization, as a movement. And fast forward to the 60s, that's what a lot of these Black Power advocates were saying, especially Hobson, which is because he's like, he's so fascinating. He starts off with the branch, then he moves to CORE, and then ACT. You know, how many activists go like to three or four different organizations?
Yeah, and you can keep going. The Statehood Party. I mean, you're absolutely right. I mean, he was a tough guy to get along with. He could be very authoritarian in the way that he interacted with people and organizations. And that's essentially the knock on him that led to his ejection from CORE. But let me pull back a second, because, I think it's important to point out that these Black Power activists, I wouldn't say that they sort of crushed I think they hastened their demise is another way to put it, by heightening the contradictions, by sort of pointing out the contradictions that were actually growing more contradictory in this moment. So it's important to remember that the NAACP's power, particularly in the 60s, I'm sorry, in the 50s, is their ability to get access to powerful white people, right? You know, they're not like an insurgent street organization, right? Like they're working through the courts. Mm-hmm. They're doing sort of brokerage politics behind the scenes, and they're actually making progress, right? I mean, they're getting a small amount of reform and a small amount of resources for Black folk. But we have to remember, like, that events and population flows really sort of marginalize that style of politics because they're just not tenable anymore. So in 1950, the Black population in DC is about 250, maybe 280,000. By 1965, I think it's 400 plus. So you just have Black people, most of them poor, right? Most of them, sort of the people who are being pushed off the land in North Carolina and Virginia, even far South Carolina, escaping, the shutdown of the school system in Prince Edward County, because, the county government basically says, we got to send our kids to school with Black people. But nobody's going to have school, right? Mm-hmm. Those people are flooding into the city, and they really strain that old system. If you have a relatively small Black population with, a disproportionately large Black affluent population as compared to other cities, right? Then you can have that type of brokerage politics and kind of keep the peace. But then when you dump an extra pretty desperately poor 150,000, 200,000 Black folks on top of that scenario, it just doesn't work anymore. And keep in mind that internally, the city is creating more destitute Black people. Southwest may be a poor community, but it's a reasonably well-organized community socially, right? Mm-hmm. And it's just wiped off the map. 23,000 people. Good luck. Go find a place to stay after urban renewal. And those people are pushed into the east of the river neighborhoods and into Shaw and Columbia Heights, destabilizing those places, right? Socially destabilizing those places. You also have gentrification happening in Foggy Bottom, Capitol Hill. There's still a little bit of it happening in Georgetown. Those people are getting pushed out, right? In the midst of all this, you have predatory landlords going into the older Black communities, snapping up houses, and then doing nothing to fix them up, just waiting for the federal government to come in and do another urban renewal. And they'll get paid that way, right? Mm-hmm. So in the meantime, we'll let the houses deteriorate. These people can live like savages because we don't care. We're absentee landlords. And then we'll get paid on top of it, right? And the crazy thing about all this is they're still overcharging people for these slum apartments more than they would for comparable apartments in white neighborhoods, mm-hmm. right? So they're getting paid coming and going. And we're so confident in their ability to do so based on who was enforcing the laws that they cop to it to the Washington Post in 1968, April 1968. Washington Post interviews all these slumlords. They're just like, yeah, I'm just letting everything go to seed, letting these Negroes live like they want, like dogs. and then I'll get a payout on the back end. Either urban renewal or gentrification is going to get me a payout. But in the meantime, I'm not fixing any windows. I'm not fixing any boilers. To hell with the roof, right? Mm-hmm. And, you know, I mean, 75% of the units in Shaw are owned by absentee slumlords. 75%, right? And so all that is happening, and that old system of brokerage just can't manage it. And so when Julius Hobson steps up, or, you know, Stokely Carmichael, or, you know, Colonel Jeru Ahmed Hassan of the Black Man's Liberation, Volunteer Army of Liberation, when they step up and say, you know, these liberals, these older people have sold you out for a mess of pottage. We want to get you a proper bowl so you can eat like these white folks. Mm-hmm. Black DC residents say, I'm with that guy.
Right. The your website and your presentation, there's so much information that you've shared and material. Just going back to the machinery of the website, what were some of the challenges that you encountered? It's hard to put everyone's story in the website, and I'm sure, assuming that you had some, criticism aside from all the praise, but just speak a little bit about what it was like to produce this.
It's a great question. So I had two huge problems. The first was that I chose to do this as a map. I thought it would be cool. So, you know, Chris Myers Ash and I came up with this idea of a map, primarily from a wonderful young woman who's an archivist at the Kiplinger Library in the DC History Center. And she had found these beautiful historical pictures of DC in 1952. And she had created a map with her husband where she put the pictures of 1952 next to a Google Maps picture today. And you could literally tour the city at two different moments in time. It's called Weimer's DC, I believe. Mm-hmm. And I was struck by it. I went back to Chris and I said, we've got to do something like this for Chocolate City to get people who aren't going to pick up the book to consider it. Mm-hmm. And so for those of you who've read Chocolate City, you know, each chapter starts in a place, right? And so we thought, okay, we'll just do a simple website with, you know, 14 places, one for each chapter. And we'll literally just use what we already wrote in the book. And we got tired. I mean, you know, we just written a 600 page book. We were like, yeah, we're not building a website too. So it sort of sat on the shelf. Mm-hmm. And, but you know, it sort of came back up when I found people just asking so much about the Chocolate City years. And I realized that there was an opportunity to do the website in a different way. And so I worked on this. It's also a bridge to my next project about mm-hmm. the Black Power Resurgence. Mm-hmm. And so the first problem was that, okay, I want to put everything on a map. That means I have to find an address for everything. And, you know, I actually have about 20, 30 entries that I just can't find addresses for. So they're not in the map, right? Because, mm-hmm. You know, when you're going for sort of, you know, a comprehensive story here, like I set out to find every major Black Power organization and event in a 30-year period, then there's just going to be a lot of stuff that you're going to be able to find most of the information for. Like I could write up a little scenario. I might even be able to find a picture, mm-hmm. but I couldn't find an address. And so that stuff is sitting on my computer waiting for, you know, sort of more time to go in the archives mm-hmm. and actually dig up an address. So the mapping part was just tough, you know, because typically as a historian, like you can say it happened in Shaw. You don't need the actual address, right? But you know, when you're working with geolocation software, like you actually have to have an address.
Yeah.
So that's been difficult. But you know, we were able to find 185. You know, I worked with a team of students at UMBC and from other area colleges. And we were able to find a really large number of entries. And so I'm very happy about that. The other problem was just finding the proper software. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I'm not a computer guy. I did not have a very clear understanding of how to build a map. And so I sat down with a student and a colleague in the geography department at UMBC that I just played basketball with back when my knees would allow that. And he said, look, I can just whip you up a website, man. And so I sat down with this student, really sharp young guy, right? Mm-hmm. I sat down with him and we designed a website, and it looks nothing like the one that those of you who have been to the website see today. It was literally, you know, it was just one panel and it was super interactive. You could click on the links, you could toggle around yourself, you could toggle back and forth in time. I mean, it was really impressive. And what I didn't know is that he had kind of set it up with just a ton of different pieces of software. And the only way that that site could live is if periodically somebody went in and manually updated each piece of software. Mm-hmm. And you're talking about like 12 different pieces of software, and you have to go in like once a month, and you still have to debug it every once in a while. So as we tried to populate it with all this data that we had found, it just kept crashing. And so I went on this very long search. I mean, you know, to find software that could do what we wanted it to do. And the closest I could find was ArcGIS. And I was very fortunate. A lot of people at ArcGIS are here in the district. Mm-hmm. And so they were willing to help me because they thought it was just a cool project about their hometown. And so we were able to work it all out. And so we used two programs called Experience Builder for the essay and then ArcGIS Story Map for the maps. And I'm pretty happy with how it turned out. But you know, that first one, I wish we could have kept it, but it fell apart within a week.
I actually wanted to share a story with you, and also a wish before we get to the Q&A. And then please, folks, send in your questions for Derek. And it speaks to Malcolm X in the city, and also with all the naming and renaming that's going on and currently of streets and buildings and so forth. In January, we had a program on the naming of the library after King. And I got an email from former library director, Molly Raphael. She was director from 1997 to 2003. And she shared an interesting story, and I'll just read a snippet of the email. This is talking about the Board of Trustees meeting. Trustees did not normally meet at the Chevy Chase Library, but they did on the day they considered naming the library for the Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. And she was a children's librarian at this time. Mm-hmm. I was told that this was unusual, and some people thought it was being held at Chevy Chase because of its location, inconvenient for many of the Black residents who planned to attend. It's just so interesting. After some back and forth on the motion, someone from the audience stood up and said something like, "I don't know why we should name this building after King. He really just tried to appease white people. You should name the building after Malcolm X." With that statement, suddenly the idea of naming for Dr. King seemed to pick up support. The vote was called relatively quickly, and the motion passed, I think with one or two nay votes, and the deed was done.
Oh, that's funny.
And it's just interesting because the DC Public Library Archives collection is somewhat open, somewhat processed. There's a lot that is not. It's about 600 plus boxes. Mm-hmm. I just pray as an archivist that story is buried in there. Cause it, I mean, you can glean so much from this email, and that's just from one person, you know, this idea of, you know, because King arguably had more of a visible role in DC than Malcolm X, but you had, you know, like once it's like, oh no, we can't have it named after anybody but Malcolm X.
Yeah.
You know,
that's great. I mean, so, you know, Malcolm X, of course, was very clear about that dynamic. And so for those of you who know some of his famous speeches, you know, he would regularly towards the end of his life, particularly his speech in Selma, Alabama in 1965 during the voting rights campaign, he would say, like white authorities, Dr. King is here and he's offered you some pretty reasonable demands. And if you listen to him, you'd be in good shape, because if you don't listen to him, folks are going to get really angry and they're going to start listening to me. And I'm not asking, I'm telling. That's a basic pitch, right? And so the idea was always that, you know, he could be sort of the boogeyman to King's left. And white Americans would sort of, you know, go with King's ask, which Malcolm X, I think very clearly understood was not exactly what he wanted, but it would do the trick, at least in that moment. Right. Mm-hmm. They had a tremendous amount of respect for each other, according to people like Peniel Joseph, who just wrote a twin biography of the two, The Sword and the Shield, that came out, I think, last year. Mm-hmm. That's hysterical. And keep in mind, too, that, you know, the renaming of the city that happens, you know, from the Black Power movement all the way up through the 1990s is a flashpoint. I mean, you've got people like Malik Edwards demanding the renaming of Malcolm X Boulevard. I think that happened in the late 80s, city took a long time because it was in bad shape to actually change the signs, right? But that's happening, you know, a solid 20 years after Malcolm's death. You had the renaming of Malcolm X Park, and even the demand by people like Julius Hobson to teach Malcolm X's speeches in DCPS schools and to make Malcolm X's birthday a city holiday. I mean, all that's happening in the late 1960s, just a couple years after Malcolm X is assassinated. And so in the midst of that, right, they'd already renamed, Meridian Hill Park, Malcolm X Park, that, you know, people were more than willing when Julius Hobson's like, yeah, let's have school off for Malcolm X. You know, the more conservative members of the school board were like, yeah, we can teach Black history. You know,
right.
That's cool. That's not, you know, controversial anymore.
Right.
When the alternative is like, you know, a big old parade for Malcolm X and the day off.
Right. Right. And also just with the rename of the library, like, it's always fascinated me, you know, naming it for a person who was not a native Washingtonian. I mean, there were so many others, not Frederick Douglass, Anna Julia Cooper, Mary Church Terrell, the Grimke brothers, someone who was not a native Washingtonian. I was gonna another question. Oh yeah, I really wanted to ask you this. You have a lot of these Black militant groups that have emerged, since the 60s, like this new Black Panther Party and some of these organizations who have been identified as labeled as, hate groups. Mm-hmm. Do you think that those types of organizations negatively affect the legacies of the Black Panther Party of the 60s and the Black Power movement in general? Like, what's your
opinion? So, you know, it's funny you ask this, Derek, because I was so intrigued by this question that I sort of came up with years ago when the Black Panther Party had their 35th anniversary at UDC. And they had a panel called There Is No New Black Panther Party. They were sort of saying something very similar to what you're saying, which is that, you know, these young guys, they're actually racist. They're deeply anti-Semitic. They're kind of embarrassing. We don't want them to tarnish our legacy. And it's just a panel. It's like an academic discussion. And in marches the new Black Panther Party, and they threaten these older Panthers. I mean, you're talking about like a bunch of 20-year-olds, wow, 20, 60 and 70-year-olds, like, I will jack you up type of threatening. Wow. It wasn't a joke.
Yeah.
And I thought, oh my God, I've got to write about this. So I actually wrote an article called "There Is No New Black Panther Party: The Black Power Resurgence and the Return of the Panther in the 1990s," or something like that. You can check it out if your listeners are interested in the Journal of African American History, published by our very own, based here in Washington D.C., ASALA, Association of African American Life. Okay. Mm-hmm. You know, the new Black Panther Party is a special case. And so I'll address that real quickly, and then I'll talk about sort of a larger universal like BLM. The new Black Panther Party starts in Dallas, Texas, under a guy named Aaron Michaels, as an honest effort to recreate the Black Panther Party with all of the respect due to the older, you know, Panthers, with a desire to recreate their ideology, their political strategy, all of those things. And it is eventually taken over by Khalid Abdul Muhammad, who was at that time the former national spokesman of the Nation of Islam, and who was a really, you know, had a very socially conservative politics, deeply anti-Semitic, and a very pugilistic politics that really had no place for white people at all, and really no place for black people who disagreed with him at all. And when he takes over the new Black Panther Party in Dallas, Texas, he brings all of his followers from the Nation of Islam, who actually think that these people and Khalid think that Farrakhan is being too much of a reformer. He's being too soft in the 1990s. Mm-hmm. And so they go and join the new Black Panther Party. And at that point, they fundamentally change the organization's ideology, its style of politics, and it becomes a fundamentally different organization. And so the new Black Panther Party, even though it has the name and the iconography, it's nothing like the Black Panther Party of the
1960s. Right.
And most of the Panthers who are still around and still active, everyone from Erica Huggins to Kathleen Cleaver to Bobby Seale, I mean, in tons of activists that we don't know about, local activists like Malik Edwards, you know, they don't mess with those cats. They just don't mess with those cats because those people don't share their politics or their political practice. But that was not how it was intended initially when, you know, a bunch of young people in Dallas tried to bring the organization back in the early 1990s. Now, to your larger question, you know, about sort of organizations like BLM, I think we need to be careful about these comparisons because we have to remember that a lot of people like dead activists. You know, I mean, there's tons of conservative people who are currently trying to undermine the Voting Rights Act who think Martin Luther King was a great guy. Right.
Right.
But if Martin Luther King was really alive today, they would be fighting with him.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And so sometimes when you see some you know, large numbers of Americans say, well, I really liked Dr. Martin Luther King, but I don't like you, Black Lives Matter, because you're different. They're just blowing smoke.
Right. That's.
And so I think you have to be careful about it. I think it's important to have an honest conversation about how contemporary activists are different than historical activists. Mm-hmm. But I think we have to make sure that we're having that conversation with people who are being honest about what they're trying to get at.
Agreed. Let's see. Another question for you. Did J. Edgar Hoover try to crush the Black Power movement in D.C. similar to the way he did in, obviously, California with Governor Reagan?
Yeah.
Or was it different?
You know, I don't know is a simple answer. And I, you know, admittedly, I should, you know, my first book was, you know, the first half of the book was all about FBI and police surveillance of Black elected officials and Black activists. And I had to make a decision with the current project with Black Power in D.C. And that was, am I going to do the sort of deep archival research here, or am I going to try and, you know, go broad as opposed to going deep? And particularly when it comes to FBI files, you know, it's almost impossible to go broad with them. Mm-hmm. You can go deep on a couple of people, but, you know, like, you order a file, it takes a couple months. You then have to dig through the file and just decipher it. Sometimes mm-hmm. you have to order a second time, hoping that they'll redact it slightly differently so you can get some information that they mm-hmm. kept from you. Mm-hmm. And so there's no question that the FBI was very concerned about the activists in their backyard, and that they had files on many of the activists who were working here in the city. Because keep in mind, many of the activists who were working in the city were some of the most important and most skilled Black Power organizers in the country. People like Kwame Ture, but also people like Jimmy Garrett, who's one of the foremost advocates of Black independent schools. Baba Zulu, the founder of Ujamaa Shule and Ujamaa Shop. I mean, you could go on and on and on, right? Etta Horn, powerful welfare activist. So all of those people have files, but I have not pulled all of their files, and I cannot say to you for sure what exactly the FBI intended for them. And so for that, I apologize.
No problem. Well, I want to thank you again, Derek. Your project, your website, I like to say it's just another wonderful example that shatters the whole idea that the history of Washington is all about federal Washington. It's not just the memorials and the monuments, the Capitol, the White House. So thank you once again. I look forward to, I know I'm sure I speak for many when I said I look forward to your book coming out. Folks, please check us out at dclibrary.org, the People's Archive. Our online finding aids are available on site, online. The Julius Hobson papers are available for research. And you can also sign up for our newsletter check us out on our Facebook page as well. And I am looking forward to seeing you all in the building soon. As you know, the pandemic restrictions are easing. And I'm really looking forward to seeing folks in the building. We have moved on up like the Jeffersons. In the old building, we were on the third floor, room 307. We are now on the fourth floor, and we do have a wonderful exhibit in our space, permanent exhibit on Dr. King and his activism in DC as well. So again, thank you all. Thank you, Derek. I really appreciate it.
And thank you, Derek. And I can't wait to get back down to MLK and get back in the Washingtonian.
Yes, yes. People's Archive. You got to.
People's Archive. Pardon me. Pardon me.
I understand. It'll always be Washingtonian to me. Thank you, Derek.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good night, everyone.